Hello, hi, I am Thekla Petridou, a psychologist and an author. This is my YouTube channel, and the video you're watching is the video in English, which is uploaded on my channel on Friday, the 24th of April, 2020. I apologize to my viewers in English, because for the last month or so, I haven't uploaded any video in English, because I was too busy dealing with the requests of Greek viewers because of the world pandemic of COVID-19. And I shouldn't have, but I have neglected uploading videos in English in the last month. Hopefully, from this Friday, starting on every Friday and during lunchtime, one video will be uploaded in English. Today's subject comes from an email from a viewer which points out in something very interesting. I'm reading the email right away. Dear Thekla, one might think that it is odd to address my question regarding the possibility of abuse of self-help videos to a person who produces videos with this content. But I could not think of a more appropriate person to ask this question but you. For those of you that haven't watched me before, I'm a psychologist, an author. I stopped seeing clients in my office 2 years ago, and daily I upload videos, self-help videos or psychoeducational videos on my YouTube channel in Greek mostly, and every Friday video in English. So here I go. I would genuinely love to hear your thoughts on the following matter. Do you think that it is possible for someone to use self-help or self-improvement videos as a numbing mechanism or as an escaping mechanism in order to avoid taking action to the direction of actively improving one's quality of life? Very interesting question. Defense mechanisms are subconscious mechanisms that our psyche, our brain uses in order to avoid confronting internal conflict, internal psychological and emotional pain. So you suggest that it might be possible for someone to watch videos like my videos or other channels, self-help or self-improvement videos or psychoeducational videos, as a defense mechanism in order to feel well without actually doing something to improve herself. I am a person with an inherent inclination towards addictions. Here you go, me also. I think it's genetic. There is a genetic predisposition for developing addictions. And I don't have any psychology-related academic background. Just by observing the effect that addictions have on me, I think I have reached a vague understanding of the way addictions work on the human brain, as escaping or numbing mechanisms. Any kind of addictions, you name it, I could easily find myself abusing it. Sugar, chocolate, smoking, alcohol, and recently, YouTube videos. I've been there abusing sugar in the past or chocolates. I've managed to become a diabetic. Of course, there is a genetic factor in this. I'm a diabetic type 2, so I do not take any sugar. I do not use any sugar or any chocolates at all. I used to abuse alcohol when I was younger, and I used to chain smoke when I was younger. So there you go. We have similar genes, possibly, or similar psyche. I have consciously, my English is not good. I can understand something I read, but to pronounce it is a different matter. I have conscientiously kept relatively safe distances from drugs and gambling all my life, me also. Oh, you are so much like me. Because I believe in the validity of the famous saying, the chains of habit are too weak to be felt until they are too strong to be broken. True. Because addictions are relief mechanisms with increased adaptability that help us tolerate an often unrecognized or invincible underlying problem, or more than one underlying problems, it is very common that if we achieve to overcome an addiction, another addiction appears to replace it, since the underlying problem still exists. True. The young baby replaces the addiction, the so-called addiction to breastfeeding, with the so-called addiction to sucking a plastic pacifier or their thumb. The smokers who force themselves to quit smoking might turn to chocolate or vape or cigarette or wine for comfort. If they are forced to quit sugar or alcohol, they might turn to overeating for comfort. True. And then if one decides to go on a diet, one might find oneself addicted to the sense of self-control that comes together with dieting and so on. And this is the mechanism, one of the mechanisms that underlies the formation of anorexia nervosa. In the above context, isn't it reasonable to be afraid that too many YouTube videos, or books for that matter, with self-help content can lead to an addiction? Is it safe for us to indulge fearlessly in the pleasure of watching videos that make us feel so unexpectedly well, like yours? Or is it perhaps possible that the next DSM edition will contain the term Thekla-mania? You invented the term. In order to describe the abuse of self-help content. Just kidding about the term, but you get the point. Your videos are rich in psychoeducational information, and some of them are true samples of wisdom. For example, your largely autobiographical but also philosophical vlog dated 9th of August 2019 with title Love Relationships Do Not Bring Happiness is perhaps my most favorite video ever in the entire ocean of YouTube. And trust me, I have watched quite a lot of them. But as surreal as it may sound, would you ever self-sacrificingly advise a huge fan of your work, like myself, to quit Thekla binging, to go cold turkey if they have to, and just try to get a life? If someone else asked for my advice on the subject, I would advise them to continue benefiting from the help provided by these videos, by maximizing as possible the active utilization of the information obtained. For example, by journaling, by taking notes of the thoughts, feelings, or memories provoked by each video that had an impact in their psychology. But pretty much like psychotherapy might not work for everyone, systematic journaling is not for everyone either. The above advice would not work for me. I'm usually so tired of words in my over-articulated life that I don't feel like writing anything, let alone journaling. My demanding job and my family obligations don't leave me enough time or strength to even note down my daily chores or work tasks at the end of the day as thoroughly as I would wish. So what would your advice be? Thank you in advance for sharing your thoughts in the above topic. Looking forward to your video reply. Once again, I apologize for me not being able to read English as fluently as you write it. Addictions. I have the opinion that everything is life, every achievement you have in life is addiction like, is like an addiction. For example, if you start dieting, being addicted to dieting can help you achieve the result you wish, to have a healthier body, for example, or to lower your blood sugar, or to lower your cholesterol levels and so on, or to shed some fat away. You need to be addicted to daily routine, addicted to getting up in the morning, addicted to washing your face, addicted to showering once or twice a day. There are good addictions and bad addictions. This is my opinion. I don't know if somebody might have a bad addiction, but watching my videos. I didn't know about other people's videos because I don't have enough time to watch videos. I do also watch YouTube videos, but most of the time on other topics, not on psychology topics. What's the prerequisite to consider that a daily routine could be labeled as an addiction? It's not only the occurrence of how much times you do this over and over. I mean, for example, like watching 5 videos a day or 3 videos a day or 2 videos on a daily basis, which is too much. I mean, on my channel, I produce in Greek 2 or 3 videos a day. I produce too many, I know, because I'm in the process of eliminating my email, the email that I have received over the last year as requests from viewers to make videos for them. So at this point in my life, I work full time on YouTube and I produce 2 to 3. Psychoeducational videos. I name them not self-help or self-improvement videos, but you might also use that term. In order to label something as addictive, as in a clinical term, it should make you dysfunctional. If watching my YouTube videos makes you dysfunctional in a way that you do not get rest in order to watch the videos, you do not get enough sleep in order to watch the videos, you do not get exercise in order to watch videos, you do not go to your job in order to watch videos, you do not feel like socializing in order to watch videos, yes, you have an addiction. And yes, you should try to address your addiction. I'm not sure if going cold turkey is something that really cures an addiction, because as you wisely wrote in your email, when we cut an addiction, then it's most possible that we will go to another addiction. Whereas when you overcome an addiction, it's rarer to adapt to a new addiction. For example, if somebody stops abusing alcohol after psychotherapeutic treatment or after taking a course for this matter, then they might not become addicted to something else. I mean, if you take therapy for your addiction. So if addiction is this, like I would stop doing important things, necessary things for my daily function in order to watch the videos, yes, it's an addiction. It looks like an addiction in the clinical sense. And yes, you should seek professional help for addressing it. Not going cold turkey, address professional help. Because I believe that the problem with unresolved addictive people who go from one addiction to another is because they cut cold turkey and they do not have any therapy in order to overcome the addiction. We do not want to cut the addiction, we want to overcome it. We want to make the situation normal. For example, I told you that in the past I used to abuse alcohol. What I mean, from year 2008 to roughly 2013, for 5 years, I used to drink, to consume on a nightly basis. Every night I used to consume at least one bottle of red wine. Every night. No matter what, I would consume that wine, I would become tipsy and I would go to bed. This was alcohol abuse. I did not stop cold turkey. I started doing therapy and slowly I reduced the amount of alcohol I had. And right now I might drink alcohol once a month or once every 2 or 3 months, and I will drink up to 2 wine glasses, not a bottle anymore. I didn't cut my addiction cold turkey. I went into therapy. I found out what was the reason that triggered my addiction to alcohol, and I worked out that way, not by myself, with the help of a colleague, of another psychologist. So addictions are dangerous to us when they affect our ability to function normally in our lives. And as for the content of my videos in English or in Greek, mostly in Greek, because I think we have roughly 35 videos in English only so far. I hope in the future I will be able to speak English more fluently and produce more videos in English. As for the content of my videos, you know, since you watch the videos so regularly, that I prompt people to go for psychotherapy, to ask to find a therapist, to undergo psychotherapy. I do not believe that my videos by themselves, or just by watching a video, you can cure yourself from anything. And I think that my videos are mostly psychoeducational in terms of giving psychological knowledge to the people who watch them, in order to be able to identify when it's a good time for them or when it's necessary for them to undergo psychotherapy, or to have some mostly spiritual thinking about human relationships, because I really do like the existential approach of psychotherapy and the spiritual connection that you can use psychological knowledge in order to help yourself become a better person, or to help yourself embark on a spiritual journey in order to find happiness in life. My English is rusty. I should exercise it more often. And next Friday, I should certainly upload a new video. Hi, everybody. Have a lovely weekend. Bye.